want to take time, because tomorrow is Memorial Day, we do want to take a moment in our service today. We do want to remember, we do want to honor those that paid the sacrifice, the ultimate sacrifice for our country, and we don't want to just forget them. We don't want to forget that sacrifice. And so I do want to just take a minute. I want to ask if any are in here, I want you to stand. If any are in here who have a friend, maybe it was a close friend or some family member that died in battle and service to our country, someone that gave their life, if you have a friend or a family member like that, would you stand for just a moment? Friend or family member that died in service to our country. Let's pray. Let's pray for just a minute. Many people are touched by this. Father, Lord, we thank you for these that are in our room here this morning who had a close friend or had a family member who died in service to us, in service to this country, to be able to protect the freedom that we have and that we enjoy. We get to have a holiday tomorrow because of the sacrifice, the giving of their lives. And so, Father, we pray for each friend and family member here today that this weekend, that as they reflect back on their friend or their loved one that paid this ultimate price, Father, we pray that they would know your peace and that they would know your strength, they would know your comfort in the absence of the loss that they have experienced. We do remember. We don't forget. We honor those that are fallen, the heroes of our country. We lift them, these families up. We pray for a special touch from you for them in Jesus' name. Things before we get into the message that I do want to just mention to you briefly. If you're here today and you're a guest with us, you're visiting with us, I do want to say a special welcome to you. I'm glad that you're here with us today. If you didn't stop by the guest table on your way in, then there is a connect card inside the bulletin there that tears out. I would love for you to take a moment and fill that connect card out, and you can put it in the offering plate, which we'll pass later in the service, where you can take it by the Welcome Center and just hand it in there before you leave. We have a little gift for you. We would like to get into your hands. And so be sure to do that for us. We would really appreciate it. And then also a couple things coming up that I wanted to mention to you. One is coming up next week. And for some reason, this is not. Did you do that or did I do that? You did it? All right. You got it. You just control it. And then about it. Next Sunday night, we're starting a new series through the summer. We're doing these things called Table Talks on Sunday nights, and so I want to encourage you to make an effort to be a part of that with us through the summer. There's an insert in your bulletin that tells exactly what that is, and then on the back of that insert, it tells you an outline of what we're going to be doing, but we're going to be going through this book study together on Sunday nights called The Pursuit of Holiness. I promise you, there is nothing greater you can do in your life at all than to pursue holiness. Nothing greater you can do in your life than to pursue holiness. And what is that? Well, that's what we're going to talk about over the next few weeks on Sunday nights as we come together. And the way the format will be is we'll take about 15 or 20 minutes each Sunday night to kind of teach the basic principles and concepts from that chapter or chapters from that week. So if you didn't get the book, you can still show up and we'll go over the material, and then we'll break up into round tables, and you can sit with people that you know and that you like and hopefully you're comfortable with, and hopefully they like you, and they just sit with people you're comfortable with, and there'll be a discussion guide for you to kind of just walk through that discussion guide. We'll have a couple tables where teens can sit together with the youth leader, kind of leading them through it, and kids can do the same thing, and they can be led through it, and then we want you to be able to interact with each other for a few minutes around the discussion guide questions from that study and from that book and from those chapters. And so this will help us get a little deeper into it. And then we'll have a few minutes of just, hey, cross-learning from everybody, where we'll just ask the different tables to share a few things so that we can learn from one another together as a whole church family. And so I'm excited. I'm looking forward to it. Holiness is a big deal. The scripture commands us in two places. God says, be holy, for I am holy. Once in the Old Testament, and then that command is repeated again in the New Testament in 1 Peter. God says, be holy, for I am holy. We don't know what holiness is today. And so we have all these misconceptions about what that means. Like that's like it means you're a holier than thou, or you're self-righteous, or you think you're perfect. But it doesn't mean any of those things. It means something very important. It's a command that God has given us. And then it also says in Hebrews that without holiness, no one will see the Lord. No one will see the Lord without holiness. And so we better know what this means. And so I want to encourage you to come be a part of this study with us. If you're not able to make it out on Sunday nights, I would encourage you to pick the book up at our bookshelf back there. You can pay at the Welcome Center for that. And then just go through it with us together. Even if you're not able to come on Sunday night, go through that book with us together this summer. I promise it will be enriching to you and will build you up. This is a great book that we ought to read and reread and chew on and study. And so be sure to pick that up. All right. I better stop there because I'm going to give away the whole thing and just preach that today, and I've got something else to say. But the last thing I want to mention is tonight we have service as well. Pastor Dan will be continuing a series that he's doing for us right here, 6 o'clock. I hope you'll be back for that tonight. All right, let's jump into the message today. You can turn to Genesis chapter 29 in your Bibles. Genesis chapter 29. We're continuing in our series called Redo, Learning to Live from the Life of Jacob. And so we've spent several weeks going through the life of Jacob so far. We've got a few weeks left to go through as we work our way through his life. Much of it we are learning in reverse, or we're learning the opposite, in a sense, in his life. And so we're continuing in this, Genesis chapter 29. Before we jump in today, I want to bring back a little segment, just get you to interact with me a little bit. I want to bring back a little segment. It's an old 80s game show that was on TV called Name That Tune. Any of you ever watched that show on TV back in the 80s on the black and white? Did they have color TV back then? Anyway, all right. Yeah, they did, obviously. Right? All right, Name That Tune. So we got one song. I got one song. I want to use this today to kind of segue into our message. I got one song, about 15 seconds of a little audio clip, and I want to see if you can guess this tune. I've got a prize for whoever guesses it. So we got 15 seconds. Listen to this. Who knows that? Raise your hand. Who knows that tune besides Dan? Who knows that? Somebody take a guess. There's nothing. Well, if you miss, you owe $1,000 to the 2020 Vision. All right, but so don't guess wrong. No, just kidding. Who? Somebody guess. Anybody know that? All right. Can I help you out a little bit? All right, I'm gonna help out a little bit. What? Yes. It is Brooks and Dunn. How many of you know Brooks and Dunn? Throw their picture up there. Brooks and Dunn. A Brand New Man. Hey, I've got a gift for you, Karen. All right. Yeah, give her a round of applause because I'm about to shame her. All right, so look, this book, I'm going to give you this. It's called Living by the Book. All right, so just come get it after service. If you will study this in your Bible as much as you've studied country music, I promise your life will be a lot more pleasing to God. All right. That's all I'm saying. All right. Yeah, this is Brooks and Dunn. That's a clip from Brooks and Dunn. It was a 1991 single that debuted as a hit single in June of 1991, way back when. And it's called Brand New Man. The lyrics go like this. I saw the light. I've been baptized by the fire in your touch and the flame in your eyes. I'm born to love again. You don't have to sing it. Just say it. All right, first verse one. Well, the whole town's talking about the line I'm walking that leads right to your door. Oh, how I used to roam. I was a rolling stone. Yeah, I used to have a wild side. They say a country mile wide. I'd burn those beer joints down. Karen. But he says, that's all changed now. You turned my life around. Whoa, I saw the light. I've been baptized by the fire in your touch and the flame in your eyes. I'm born to love again. I'm a brand new man. Verse 2. Y'all want to hear it instead? All right, play verse 2 in the chorus. Here comes the chorus. All right, we better stop there. We better stop there. Because like some of y'all, I didn't see you that excited when we were singing a few minutes ago, all right? This song came to my mind this past week as I was thinking about this sermon for today. When I was a kid growing up in the 90s, traveling with my grandfather back and forth during the summer from work every day, this was the stuff, man. This was what was on the radio all the time, these early 90s country songs, and Brooks and Dunn were certainly a great part of that. But this was one of those songs that came to mind because when we come to, he talks about being changed. I mean, this whole thing, and the music video is even better. You got to go see that sometime. You can find it on YouTube. But the whole thing is about how he's been changed. His whole life has been changed because he met this woman. That's the whole message of the song. He meets this woman, and his whole life has been changed, and he becomes a brand new man. Now, in Genesis 29, what we're going to see today is that Jacob has in fact become a brand new man. We've been kind of tracing his story. He has become a brand new man. He has seen the light. He's been baptized, if you will, but not by the fire in a woman's eyes or the flame in her touch or anything like that, but by the vision of God. Jacob has been changed by the vision of God that he had at Bethel that we looked at last week. In that vision, God promised Jacob that he would be married, that he would have children, that he would be provided for and protected while he went away to Laban's, and that he would come back safe to the land. Now, to be clear, in the story today, Jacob is going to meet a woman. He's going to meet a woman in the story today by a well. And seeing this woman is going to compel Jacob to a display of incredible strength, tender service, and an emotional outburst of passion. But it's not just meeting this woman that changes this. It's not just meeting this woman that causes all of this from Jacob. No, there's a lot more going on than that. So I want us to read the story for ourselves. Then we're going to unpack it. Then we're going to make some applications from it. Genesis chapter 29, we just have 14 verses to look at today. So look at Genesis chapter 29, and let's read this together. Says this, the Bible says, then Jacob went on his journey. Just had the experience at Bethel where he saw the ladder and he saw God at the top. He saw the Lord at the top of it. He saw the angels ascending and descending, and God had just given him the promise of provision and protection. And after that, he gets up and he makes that the monument. He sets the stone up and he pours oil on it. We looked at that last week. And then it says he went on his journey. This is where we're at today in verse 1. Jacob went on his journey and he came to the land of the people of the east. That's all he knew. I mean, he didn't have a GPS. He didn't know exactly where he was going. He just knew he had come to the land of the people in the east. And as he looked, he saw a well in the field. And behold, three flocks of sheep lying beside it. For out of that well, the flocks were watered. The stone on the well's mouth was large, and when all the flocks were gathered there, the shepherds would roll the stone from the mouth of the well and water the sheep and put the stone back in its place over the mouth of the well. Jacob said to them, my brothers, where do you come from? They said, we are from Haran. He said to them, do you know Laban, the son of Nahor? They said, we know him. He said to them, is it well with him? They said, it is well. And see, Rachel, his daughter, is coming with the sheep. He said, behold, it's still high day. It's not time for the livestock to be gathered together. Water the sheep and go pasture them. But they said, we cannot until all the flocks are gathered together and the stone is rolled from the mouth of the well. Then we water the sheep. While he was still speaking with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherdess. Now, as soon as Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, Jacob came near and rolled the stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother. Then Jacob kissed Rachel and wept aloud. Jacob told Rachel that he was her father's kinsman and that he was Rebekah's son, and she ran and told her father. As soon as Laban heard the news about Jacob, his sister's son, he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to his house. Which, as I was reading that, I was thinking, like, every dad of a daughter ought to just practice that. When the guy comes over, you know, to take your daughter out, just give him a kiss. You kiss him and see how things go. Anyway, I think it would just be a good application from that text. But anyway, as soon as Laban heard the news about Jacob, his sister's son, he ran and met him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to his house. And Jacob told Laban all these things. And Laban said to him, "Surely you are my bone and my flesh." And he stayed with him a month. Got a lot of things kind of going on here in just these few verses that I want to unpack for us today. And I want us to make some application from this. Jacob has changed from his experience in Bethel. He set out on this direction, heading to Laban's, but he knows that God has promised to protect him and provide for him and to bring him back safe. And that changes everything for him. Excuse me. I've kind of organized the message today around this thought, that when you know you are doing God's will, that He is in control of your life, and you have His promise of provision and protection, you experience three amazing results. Now, the first thing I need to do is explain to you how it is that we get to this from the story here. How is it that we get to this point where we know that this is what's going on, that Jacob is a man who knows that he's doing God's will, he knows that he has God's promise of protection. Were you drinking that? So he knows that he has God's promised protection and provision. There's ice in this. Sorry. And so I want to show you how we know that. How do we take that from this? The narrative here in Genesis 29 is making it very clear to us that God is moving Jacob's life along. All right, this section that we just read, these 14 verses, it's very clear when we study this scripture that it's evident that God is the one moving Jacob right along, that God is in fact with him, that he knows he is doing what God has called him to do in this moment. First of all, we have a stone that's mentioned twice. The text talks about this stone that's covering the mouth of the well, and we'll get into in a minute why that stone was there. But this stone mentioned several times, it reminds us of the previous stone that we just read about at the end of chapter 28, the stone that Jacob had laid his head on. And then he got up that night because God had appeared to him in that vision and told him these things and said, "I will be with you and protect you and bless you and will bring you back." And he took the covenant promised to Abraham, and then he gave it himself to Jacob. And because this stone is central to the author's writing here in Genesis 29, it tells us something. It signifies something. The place where God spoke to Jacob and promised him something was around a stone, just a stone. The stone is central to the next story here that's covering the mouth of the well, and part of it is to remind us that this event is taking place at a well where this stone is, signifying that God is doing this. This is God fulfilling this promise that he made to Jacob. The second thing is that this occurs at a well. And in that day, a well was a sign of blessing. A well was a sign of God's blessing. You needed a well in order to have life. And wherever there was a well, there was water and there was life. And that was important in a place where there wasn't much water. And so where you have wells, you have signs of God's blessing on the people in this day and age. And so that's going on, letting us know that this is God blessing Jacob. That God had said to Jacob, "You will go, you will be married, you will come back, you know, your descendants will be multiplied." And this happening at a well is significant. There's also a parallel. We don't have time to get into this today, but there's also a striking parallel between Genesis 29, what we just read, and Genesis chapter 24. If you remember Genesis chapter 24, which I'm sure most of you don't because you remember country songs, but you're not going to remember Genesis 24. But if you remember Genesis 24... Genesis 24 was the description of when Abraham, all right, who was Abraham to Jacob? Grandfather. When Abraham had Isaac, But Isaac didn't have a wife. Abraham sent his servant to go find a wife for Isaac. And in Genesis chapter 24, we have the account of that. The servant set out to go find a wife, and he finds who for Isaac? Who does the servant find for Isaac? Jacob's mother, who is Rebekah. The servant maybe comes to this very well because Laban was there. Laban was there in the story in Genesis 24. Laban was the brother of Rebekah. And the servant makes it very clear in Genesis 24 that God is directing every one of his steps to bring him to the exact place to meet Rebekah, the exact woman that God had for Isaac, for the servant to bring back so that Isaac would be married. There's an incredible parallel that's going on between that scene and between what we see in Genesis 29. In Genesis 24, it's very clear. It is explicitly stated that God is directing the steps of the servant to bring him to the well to find Rebekah. In Genesis 29, what we've just read, it's not as explicit, it's more implied. It's just implied that Jacob gets up from this vision at Bethel, and he sets out, and that God is bringing him to this place, that he is in fact doing the exact will of God, that God is in control of these events. He knew that God had planned to bless him and to protect him, that he had promised that. He knew that he would bring him back safe, that he would take him to Laban's house, even though he doesn't really know where he's going. He's setting out trying to find this. Then he comes to the very spot where this well is, the very well that's in the vicinity close to Laban's house, where Laban's sheep are coming to be watered. And who is the one coming to the well to water the sheep but Rachel? This one that Jacob believes this is more than a mere coincidence. This is God bringing the two of them together. There's also a second parallel that's going on in this text. There's a parallel with Jacob's vision and dream at Bethel. The writer uses a unique word in the scene that we looked at last week and this week, and he uses it three times. If you'll flip to the next slide, he uses this Hebrew word, hene, which is used three times, both in the story in the scene of Jacob at Bethel the night before, and in the scene with Jacob coming to the well in Genesis 29. This is a literary parallel tying the two together. All right. What we have is in Genesis 28, 12 and 13 that we looked at last week, we have three uses of this word, and that word means behold or see or look. And you have the setting, the attendance, and the focus in each of the three. And you have the word repeated again three times in the text that we've just read. Behold, last week, behold, the night before he comes to the well, he's at Bethel. Behold, there was a ladder. Here, behold, there was a well in the field. The night before, behold, angels of God ascending and descending. This day, behold, three flocks of sheep were lying by the well. The focus, the night before, behold, the Lord was standing above it. The focus, behold, Rachel was coming with the sheep. This is another parallel that just lets us know that what is happening here in the scene that we're looking at is God ordering Jacob's steps. God in control of all of these things. God said the night before, I will provide and bless and protect. And then what do we have happening the very next day? It's coming together rather quickly. God is in fact doing everything he said he would do. And the author of Genesis, using this word, is making it very clear. All of this is the writer working hard to show us that the success of Jacob here should be interpreted as God fulfilling his promise he had made to him the night before at Bethel. The text describes for us what life looks like when we are doing God's will and when we have his promise of protection and provision. It shows us what our life is like when it's been changed by our own encounter with God. So let me show you those three things. We're going to look at what we know happens. These are experiences that we have. We experience these amazing results when we know we are doing God's will, when we know he's in control of our life, and we have his promise of protection and provision. All of these things we have in Christ Jesus. He's provided for us these things. And so here are some amazing results that happen. The first is this. Number one, you live life with purpose and a spring in your step. You live life with purpose and a spring in your step. We see this in Jacob's life. His whole life changes from that experience in Bethel when he meets God. When he comes to Genesis chapter 29, verse 1, it tells us that Jacob went on his journey. The literal Hebrew phrase is that he lifted up his feet, or he picked up his feet. We don't talk like that very often, and so it just describes for us Jacob went on his journey. But the author uses a particular phrase to say to us that he got going. Like, he started moving with purpose. The night before, he's coming to Bethel, and he's worried about Esau, his brother, who had vowed to kill him. And he's setting out, leaving the land that he thought he just had inherited through the blessing. And he's going into a land looking for a family, part of his mom's side of the family that he's never been to before. He doesn't know if they're still there. He doesn't know if they're alive. He doesn't know if his mother's brother has daughters. Have they been married? He doesn't know any of these things. And he's heading out towards that direction, and he comes to Bethel, and he goes to bed that night, uncertain of his future, with all of these questions. If I've just inherited this land and this blessing, why am I leaving? And then, after God appears to him in the vision, he picks up his feet the next morning and he goes out on his journey. The author is saying his life has been changed. He's moving with purpose now. After the vision at Bethel, there was a new spring in Jacob's step. Esau no longer concerned him. He was on a mission now with the Lord's promise of protection and provision. The phrase "picked up his feet" is a clue that suggests Jacob has confidence in the Lord, that his confidence in God is high, that he believes God will in fact lead him directly to Laban and will do just as he has said he would do. In this phrase that he picked up his feet, he set out quick. He didn't get up the next morning wondering what to do. No, he moved with purpose. And the text indicates Jacob had high faith and confidence in God at this moment. Jacob had been changed. He has a purpose now. He is on a mission now. He is living life with purpose because he knows God has called him to do this. He's moving to go in this direction, and he believes God will see him through to that. This is what happens when our life becomes changed. When we meet God, we get a purpose in life, and we can move and live, and we don't just go through the motions anymore. And it's not just about, you know, trying to keep up with the Joneses. It's not just about living and eating and sleeping and repeating and going to work and then staying home. And then it's not just about the cycles of every day. We actually have a purpose and a reason for living now because we know once we've met God and encountered him that God has a reason for us to live. One guy read a story of Josh McDowell where he had talked to a guy who's a professional headhunter, and this professional headhunter would go into companies and corporations, and he would meet with and he would interview top high-level CEOs trying to find out if they'd be a good fit and match for another company that was looking for someone like that. And so this headhunter would go in and he would sit and he would interview, he would meet with these guys, and one of the things that he would do is he would come in and he would go into the guy's office and he would loosen up his tie and he would, you know, take his jacket off and loosen his vest up, and he would kick his feet up on the guy's desk and he would start talking about baseball or basketball or sports, and he would just try to let the guy relax as he was interviewing him. Just get the guy comfortable. And somewhere through the middle of that conversation, as the guy was relaxed and comfortable, he would sit straight up in his chair and he would look across the desk at the guy and he would say, "What's your purpose in life?" He would just all of a sudden catch him off guard. And he said, guys had not really thought about that. Most guys had not given that any thought. They really had no idea what their purpose in life was, and they would stumble through that. Except one time he met a guy, he said, when he did that, he leaned over and he said, "What's your purpose in life?" And the guy said, without any hesitation, "My purpose in life is to go to heaven when I die and take as many people with me as I can." That's a good purpose. I mean, this guy, just like that, he had thought through that. He had given it some thought. This headhunter said, "I'd met many guys and they struggled to answer that question, but here was a guy who knew his purpose." When we meet God, we have an experience where we meet God through Jesus Christ and we are saved. We are given a purpose in life. There is a reason why we are here. And God changes all of that. He transforms us. Tony Evans talks about a guy named Billy Taylor who does something unique. He will go to a junkyard and he will find junk that nobody wants, that they've thrown out, and he will take it back to his house, and he'll turn it into contemporary art, and he'll sell it for around $5,000 a piece, taking junk that nobody wanted and making contemporary art. This guy, Billy Taylor, will, and sell it for $5,000 a piece, some of it. He takes something that seems purposeless and meaningless, and he gives it a purpose and a reason. And that's what God does with us. You may be in here today, and you may feel like you were worthless before meeting Jesus. But once you meet him, even if we're in the junkyard, God is able to turn us into a valuable masterpiece, and God gives us a purpose for living. And Jacob, after he encounters God, he has a new purpose in his life, and he lives life with purpose and a spring in his step because he knows he's doing what God has called him to do. God will protect him. God will provide for him. He's not worried about deceiving and manipulating and conniving right now because he knows he's doing what God has asked him to do. The second is this. The second benefit that we see, the result we experience is that we can serve others. We begin to serve others with enthusiasm and joy in our attitude. Jacob, when he gets to the well, the first thing he does is he meets these three shepherds sitting there by the well with their three flocks of sheep. And the story is kind of contrasting him and his attitude and act of service and them, almost as if they're kind of lazy. Like sheep, you want to be out eating and grazing when you can have them grazing, and then you would want them to be watered when you can water them, and they can't do that yet at this point, but they're just kind of laying around. And when Jacob first gets there, and he talks to them a little bit, he says, have you ever heard of Laban? And they say, yeah, we know Laban. And is it well with him? Yeah, it's well with him. And then they say, there's Rachel, his daughter, coming with some of his sheep now. And Jacob's seeing everything come together. What does he say to them? Jacob says to them, it's high day. It's not time for the livestock to be gathered together. Water the sheep and go pasture them. I mean, here he sees Rachel's coming. You guys go out there and pack. Get out of here. I mean, he's kind of like a guy on a date, and he's got his girlfriend's brother with him at the movies. And so he's like, hey, here's $5, man. Go get you some candy and soda, hanging. He's just trying to get him out of here. It's kind of what Jacob's doing here in a sense. He's like, all right, hey, you guys get out of here a little bit. Like, Jacob, here comes Rachel. You guys go on and get out of here. Well, they don't do that. We can't do that. We got to water the flock. We can't water the flock until another person gets here. Why is that? Stones in that day would have been rolled over the mouth of a well because wells would have been privately owned, and water would have been scarce and would have been hard to come by. And so if you had a well, you had something that was very important to you. You didn't want just anybody getting in it and taking it. You didn't want sand blowing in there. So they would roll this stone over in front of the mouth of the well, and it would be really large. It'd be a really large rock, almost to serve as a lock. And so what would happen is it would usually take the four of them, these three young teenage guys who are out with these sheep and Rachel, it would take the four of them working together to move this, so you couldn't just come up and anybody move it. Well, when Rachel gets there, what does Jacob do on his own? On his own, man, what does he do? He moves that stone by himself. I mean, can't you see that? Here comes Rachel, and he's, oh man, let me show you something. And he rolls that stone out of the way on his own, sort of displaying his strength in a sense, if you will. Sort of like a fifth grader trying to show off, and he pops a willy, or a redneck in his famous last words, hey, y'all, watch this kind of thing. But Jacob is impressing her maybe here. But the point is that he moves this out of the way, and then he doesn't just move the stone and flex. He then goes and he gets water, and he begins to go around, and he begins to water the sheep for Rachel. He serves her with enthusiasm and joy in his attitude because he's been changed by his encounter with God. Jacob doesn't come to this moment and see what's happening and taking place and think, how do I need to twist and manipulate and deceive to work things out? He just serves with enthusiasm and joy in his attitude. He's been changed by his encounter. Can learn now, as he's beginning to do, to trust God to take care of things. You don't have to manipulate everything yourself. You just move it serve with joy, help, God will take care of everything else. And that's what Jacob's beginning to learn. You know, I don't know how many of you have had any encounters with customer service people at retail stores lately, but I must have, like, just not been out in the world for years, because it seems like everything has just changed all of a sudden. Like, the other week, we were going over to Target to take some things back to return to the store. We had gotten some extra gifts for the baby that were just more. We had doubles, and so we're taking stuff back. And so we're going to Target. We go to customer service, and Allison says, I need you to come in with me to return these, because they'll only let you return stuff to the store for store credit 3 times in a year. You have to show your license. They scan your driver's license, and after the 3rd time you bring stuff back and return it to the store for store credit, that's your limit. So I had to go in and do it. She'd already used my license once, so I had 2, I think. Anyway, I go in with her and tell the guy what we're going to do, and he decides he needs to check with management to make sure he can let me do that. Like I can't. I'm not sure you can do that. Well, okay. So he checks. They're okay with it. And then he scans my license, and he scans some of the clothes, and says, okay, gives us a gift card with some store credit back. Some of the others don't work, so he has to scan my license again, gets a few, has to scan it again, and this time, oh, I'm sorry, you can't do this. You've reached your limit. What? We're here 1 time. I'm just here 1 time. I'm trying to be polite. I'm asking questions, and Allison hates it when I ask questions in moments like this, but I'm asking questions, and the guy's just so nonchalant about it, chewing gum, you know, and he's just like, it's no problem. Sorry. It's no big deal. We got you. Just all you got to do is just go return the items for other items in the store right now. Just go pick out some other items right now. And you can just exchange it for other items right now. We can't give you store credit, but you can exchange it for other items in the moment. We're bringing some of these items back because we have more of these items than we need. And then he says, oh yeah, and you can't exchange it for anything in another section of the store. It's got to be in the same section. So I want to know, does it need to be the same season of clothes? So anyway, I've got all these questions, but... And he's just like, it's no big deal. Just go exchange it for some other stuff. Who comes up with these things? Like, who comes up with these return policies, right? I'm thinking customer service. It should say corporate service. They're not serving us. And then, like, I had to go into Walmart the other day and go talk to somebody at customer service, and it was a terrible experience there, too. And I'm just like, man, I haven't been out in a while or something. Like, what is going on out here today? Like, it's just like people don't want to serve you anymore. It's like it's got to serve them, and I don't understand that. Like, things have just changed today. Like, what is taking place out there? I mean, we had to take the stuff and go back home. Just take it back home. Figure out another plan. Maybe get my mother-in-law to use her driver's license and go back in there. Customer service. But look, God has changed our lives in such a way that we can serve others with enthusiasm and joy in our attitude today. We don't have to fight and protect and try to, you know, one-up people. We can just serve others. We can let go of things because we know, one, this world is not our home. We're just passing through this world. We're strangers and aliens in a land that doesn't belong to us. God has our eternity secure. We don't live for this world. We don't have to hang on to things and grab at things and protect things. We know we have God's promised provision and protection. And when we have that, and we're obedient to His word, His will, telling us what to do, when we live according to that and we do what God has commanded us to do, we can relax and we can serve other people with enthusiasm and joy in our attitude. That's one of the things that Christ does. He changes us in that way. And then the third thing that I think we see is that we recognize that providence is at work and God is in our path. You recognize providence at work. Number 3, you recognize providence at work and God in your path. If you would change that to number 3. Providence is a word we don't use a lot today. I don't know when the last time is you heard somebody use that word, but providence is a word that was used a lot by the reformers in the 1500s and 1600s. It was used a lot by the founding fathers. George Washington oftentimes spoke of providence. It was used a lot by some of the Puritans, Jonathan Edwards, some of the early colonial period of our country. There was a lot of writing that spoke of providence. What is providence? Providence speaks of God's intervention in the universe. That's what providence is. When we speak about divine providence, we're talking about God actually involving himself in the affairs of your life and the world. That's providence, that God intervenes. We don't talk much about God intervening in the world today. And I do want to say we have to be careful to balance the tension between two extremes. One extreme is that we never take responsibility and we just say it's all up to God. God's doing everything, every detail God is taking care of. We don't have to worry about anything. And everything that happens, it's just always God did it or whatever. There's an extreme that you can go too far in that regard. But there's another extreme that I think we probably fall more prey to, and that's the extreme of deism, where we sort of live our life like, well, God started the world, he wound up the clock, and then he set it in motion. And then he doesn't involve himself in it anymore. We don't want to go to that extreme either. And so we balance ourselves between the two extremes, and we recognize providence, that God does involve himself in our life, in the affairs of our life, in the affairs of the world. He didn't just start it and wind it up and let it go. See, when you know God is in control of your life, you know that you're doing his will, you can begin to look back at your life and you can see clearly God's providence at work. Have you ever experienced that before? I just want to ask you that. Have you ever experienced that before where you could look back at some events that took place in your life and you could see clearly the hand of God working and moving in those? Sometimes in the middle of it, you can't see God. You wonder where he is. Sometimes you wonder that. Sometimes you think, God can't be. I can't be in control of this. There's no way he would allow this. But you look back on that and you begin to see, no, God was involved in that. God was working in ways, bringing things about. This is what I think Jacob has here for us. He illustrates this for us. When Jacob meets Rachel, he does what would be customary. Kisses her on both cheeks. It's a form of greeting. He tells her all about himself, and first he tells her all about himself and his story and where he's come from and all of these events, and then he kisses her on both cheeks. But then it also says that he wept. He embraced her, he kissed her, verse 11, and he wept aloud. The idea of this weeping, this emotional outburst, communicates for us, it signals to us that it's not just that he's met this woman who has taken him by surprise or who has captivated him. It's not just the fire in her touch and the flame in her eyes that has captivated him. This weeping signifies that Jacob sees the hand of God in his life, that he has brought all of these events together, and that what God had told him the night before is beginning to come to pass already. And in an emotional moment, weeping, Jacob recognizes in that the hand of God. Even Laban's words to Jacob remind us of this. When Jacob goes and meets Laban, Laban says in verse 14, "Surely you are bone, you are my bone and my flesh." That language harkens all the way back to the Garden of Eden when God created Adam and Eve. "Bone of my bone," Adam said, "and flesh my flesh," two made for each other, that God had brought those together. That's what we see here in Genesis, that God is bringing the two of them together. This is his providence at work. When we know we're obedient to God, we're doing his will, we're confident that he's in control, that he's ordering the affairs of our life, that we're being obedient to his commands, we know that he has promised to provide for us and protect us. We experience these results. Our life has changed. We can serve others with joy and enthusiasm. We're not worried about protecting anything. We can live life with purpose because we know that there's meaningfulness to life. There's a purpose for why we exist. And we can recognize along the way that God is at work. We can see him in our path. We can see his hand of providence. This is what happens when we meet the Lord and we have our life changed. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes this morning? With your heads bowed and eyes closed, want to encourage you as the band is coming to get ready to lead us in some more worship. You may be at a point in time right now in your life where you don't understand what's going on. Maybe you're at a point in time where you failed to recognize God at work, or you've wondered where He is. But you can know this: if you've met Christ and you've had your life changed, you have a purpose for living. You have the opportunity now to serve with enthusiasm and joy, and God is at work in your life. He is working in your life. He didn't just wind it up and let it set in motion and then step away. He's involved. And if there are things that are happening in your life, God may be at work in ways that you need to understand, and you need to take time to think through and give Him thanks and praise and ask Him to help you see how He's bringing things to pass. Father, we worship You today. We give You praise. We give You glory. You have changed our lives. Lord, we are all, if we have been saved by the blood of Jesus, we have all been changed. We are all brand new people. Whether or not we were far, far away from You, or whether or not we felt like we lived a pretty decent life, it doesn't matter what our life looked like before Christ. We were dead in our trespasses and sins, and yet You saved us and You changed us. You gave us a purpose for living. You have totally changed our lives. For that, we give You thanks and we give You praise. Help us to recognize You at work in our life. Help us more than anything to be confident that we're doing Your will, because we've studied Your word. We've looked at what You've commanded us to do. And we are actively obeying what You have called us to do. And in doing that, we know we're doing Your will. Help us to live that kind of life for You, for Your glory. In Jesus' name we pray.